Looking at this algorithm, which allows us to recursively descend into a particular non-terminal, which has multiple productions, and whenever there is a non-terminal encounter for different productions, it recursively goes inside that particular non-terminal and tries to match other productions corresponding to that. So it turns out that although this particular recursive descent parsing, which is an implementation of top-down parsing, it has backtracking, that is the state that we are saving and then going back, etc. Because we are checking that whether the particular production matches the string of terminals and non-terminals matches or not. This particular backtracking may not always be required. It turns out, in fact, that for most of the programming languages constructs, backtracking is not required. You can do away with backtracking, and just by having typically one look ahead, you will be able to parse the programming languages constructs. The reason being that the language is typically designed in such a way that you will be able to identify what kind of terminals and non-terminals you are expecting for a particular construct. However, in case of natural languages, this backtracking becomes very, very inefficient, right? Although, and it is required in case of NLP, because there is a lot of context involved in case of NLP, right? The way we speak languages. Therefore, backtracking becomes kind of necessary. However, there are notions of tabular methods where you store the context in some way rather than always storing and restoring the context. You push that into a table form with different I and J entries, and those I and J entries essentially tell you where you are in the context, and that gets utilized for the input processing in NLP, although that is not going to be our concern. So we looked at the algorithm. Let's kind of run it on a very small example, right? So let's say that my language or the grammar corresponding to that language is starting symbol deriving CAD and A deriving AB or A, right? If this is my grammar and the input that I give is CAD, right? So CAD definitely belongs to this language, and we would like to see how this particular recursive descent or top-down parsing works in this case. So remember that we start from the start symbol, then for each production we go over, then for each of the elements into this production we go over and try to match according to the input string. If it matches, then we move ahead. If it doesn't match, then we go back and try the next production, right? So we start from the start symbol, and that is an indication that we are starting, we are doing a top-down parsing, right? So start symbol and the input that I have consumed. Gray means that I have not consumed that part. So CAD I have not yet consumed, right? And from S, I'll try to derive all of its productions in succession. Since there is only one production, that is the only thing that is possible. So I'm going to create a parse tree corresponding to CAD, where A is a non-terminal, right? So that is like I'm going recursively into SS production. At this stage, I can consume C by looking at the input. So that also matches C, and therefore I can go and then I can go over C. Now to match small a, I need to expand capital A, right? Expanding capital A requires me to apply its first production, which is A deriving small ab, right? So that is what I am going to do now. So small a deriving small ab. Now I'll try, so now the unconsumed portion is small ad. And therefore, I will try to match A's subtree along with the input that is coming, that is AD. Definitely, AB does not match AD, and therefore, I will have to unconsume whatever I had matched. So, for example, A, small a is going to get matched, so I will move the input ahead, and then I will try to match small b with small d, which is not going to match, so I will have to restore the state, and I will go back to where I have started, which is expanding the next production of A, right, capital A, right? So that consumption goes back to C after consuming small a, And with this, I'm going to try the new rule, which is A deriving A, and that matches, and therefore I consume the input. At this stage, the match has happened, as well as the string is over, and therefore I'll say that this particular string belongs to this language, and therefore this is a valid program. Any questions on this one? Okay. So let's generate the parse tree corresponding to our favorite grammar. This is of expressions after removing the left recursion. And I would like you to generate parse tree corresponding to this for the input string id plus id into id. Can you please try that? I can get you started. For example, E is the start, capital E is the starting symbol, and that should derive TE prime, because that is the only production which is possible. So TE prime will not consume anything as yet, because now we are still looking at the non-terminals. So we'll try to expand capital T having input as full string id plus id into id. So T essentially derives only FT prime, so that is also okay. Right? So I'm just going to show that. And then T derives FT prime. This part is also okay. Now the interesting part comes, that F derives parenthesized E, right? And it will then try to match opening parenthesis with ID, which is not going to match, and therefore it will restore the state, go back and try the next production, and that will be F deriving ID. Right? So I will leave the rest of it for you to figure out. I'll wait for a few minutes, few maybe seconds. Okay, I'm assuming that some of you would have finished at least some more portion of this, so let's move ahead a little bit. So now I can consume ID from the input, right, along with this F deriving ID. So now I'm at plus, and I'm going to evaluate or expand T prime. T prime has star FT prime, and that star doesn't match plus. And therefore, the only other production which I'll apply is T prime deriving epsilon. Right, so that is what I'll do here. At this stage, the derivation of capital T is over. At least, there is no other production anyway. And therefore, otherwise, if this would have failed later, then we would have tried the next production of T. But T is over, so I need to go to E prime. and I am at plus id star I. So e prime goes to plus t e prime, and that seems to match the plus, and therefore I am going to start expanding t. With the input id star id. T derives ft prime, f derives parenthesized e, that doesn't match, but f derives id, and therefore I'm going to match that f with id. And the rest of it is t prime. So t prime has star ft prime, and that matches with the star id. Therefore I match with star ft prime. And then f derives id, t prime derives epsilon, e prime derives epsilon. Right, so that turns out to be the final parse tree that gets generated with this grammar for this particular input. Any questions on this part? In these types of grammar, suppose epsilon was written first, then it would have matched. Yes, that is correct. So if we would have written the epsilon first, then it would have matched. Then you would have gone trying to match other rules, and we would have failed. And then we would have gone back and applied the next protocol. So that's a good important point, that the order in which you write the productions becomes very important when you are performing top-down parsing. Not LL1 parsing, the one that we are going to see. But if it is recursive descent parsing the way we have written, it can be optimized by reordering the productions. However, that is not very, that part is there. Unfortunately, that depends upon the kind of strings that you are going to match. So in some cases, what happens is that people try to look at the set of programs that people usually write. Right? From there, you perform an analysis that these are the productions which get utilized more often. So let's reorder these and so on. Right? So that is more like a systemic thing which comes into picture here. However, there's still a little bit of theoretical interest. The reason being that you can perform top-down parsing, and if you look at the way we have done on this particular example, you will realize that mostly by looking at that first symbol, we are able to figure out which rule to apply. We don't have to really go into F deriving parenthesized E, because we know that the next input is ID. Right? So you are able to see that by looking at the next symbol, at least this particular grammar of expressions will be able to parse the input strings without any problem, without any ambiguity, without any backtracking. So that is what is essentially the notion of LL1 grammars, which we are going to study. Any other questions? All right. So we'll move ahead from here. And for LL1 grammar, we are going to require the notion of first and follow, similar to what we had in the lexical analysis. It's going to be a little different, but conceptually at a high level, they are the same. So the top-down as well as the bottom-up parsing, these get kind of helped by the first and the follow sets. These allow us to look at where I am in the current position and what is my next position going to be based on the look ahead that I'm going to see from the input, the look ahead token, right, or set of tokens. Follow can also be used in the error recovery, in the sense that if there is some syntax error now, then how much I should consume, that can also be aided using the follow sets, as you will understand soon once we define first and follow. So if we have a production A deriving epsilon, and the input doesn't match first of epsilon, that is first character in the alpha, not epsilon, first of alpha, then we use follow of the left hand side non-terminal as the synchronizing token. Synchronizing token meaning how much should I consume, how much input should I consume till I reach that particular token. Right? So if I reach that token, that means everything until then is related to this particular construct, which is in syntax error. Therefore, let me consume all of this, and now I have gone to the synchronizing token, which is probably going to be semicolon, or it could be end of line or start of a next construct, etc. So once I reach there, then that means that a new construct is likely to start, and therefore it gets used in the error recovery. Yeah, this point will become clearer once we define these two sets. So let's define those. So first of alpha is a set of terminals, right? It's the terminal symbols which are there at the starting of the strings which are derivable from alpha. So this is very similar to what we had in the lexical analysis. So if alpha derives epsilon, so that arrow followed by star indicates that zero or more steps. This is similar to our cleaning closure. Arrow followed by plus will mean one or more steps. So if alpha derives epsilon, then alpha is also in the first of, sorry, if alpha derives epsilon, then epsilon is also in the first of alpha. This means that it is going to be a set of terminals. So whatever it can generate, the first character of that is going to be, in this case we are going to talk about not character but tokens, so because we are talking about the parsing state. So all of those should be in that particular set of first of alpha. If A derives alpha or beta, right, if capital A derives alpha or beta, then first of alpha, and if it so happens that first of alpha and first of beta are disjoint, right, that means the first token in alpha and first token of beta are disjoint. Alpha or beta are arbitrary strings of tokens and non-terminals. Then the look ahead, decides which production to apply. Right? How much should be the look ahead? Well, since first of alpha and first of beta are disjoint, you just need one look ahead. But if it so happens that first of alpha beta are the same, then you might require more such look ahead. Follow is essentially is the set of terminals. In both cases, we are talking about set of terminals that can immediately appear on the right hand side of capital A in some sentential form. What that means is that in some derivation, you are going to require, you are going to encounter some terminal as the next token out of after capital A. All of those are going to be in the follow set of A. So please bear with these definitions. It will become more concrete as we look at the example. But I'll show you a couple of derivations in general. So if capital S in zero or more steps derive alpha capital A small a beta, then follow of capital A contains A, right? So where A is a terminal and capital A is a non-terminal, small a is a terminal, right? So this seems obvious because small a is appearing as the next symbol. If you have alpha capital A B, right, and it so happens that beta is nullable, nullable is a term from lexical analysis. In this case, we will say that B can derive epsilon, that is B can derive empty string, then follow of capital A also contains small a, because B is nullable. It definitely contains first of capital B. Whatever is the first of capital B, that is also there in the follow of capital B. Similarly, if S derives alpha capital A, that is A is the last symbol in the derivation, in that particular production, then follow of A contains whatever is the follow of capital S. And if S happens to be the starting symbol, then follow of that starting symbol always contains some end marker. Earlier we said end marker in lexical analysis was sharp sign. I am going to use dollar as the end marker in this case, in the parsing tables that we are going to use. So follow of the starting symbol always contains dollar. So that is another basic definition. Right? Any confusion here? Okay, so let's try to apply those and it will become clearer soon. Okay, so let's again use our favorite expression grammar And what we are going to do is to derive what is the first of all of these non-terminals. So the first of E, E prime, T, T prime, and F, those are the ones that we are going to utilize. So what is first of capital E? Any suggestions? It's a set of terminals, set of tokens. What will be the first of E? So if you derive all the strings starting from E, what will be the first set of characters that you can have? Epsilon, opening parenthesis, ID. Okay. So why will epsilon come into picture? Sarthak? So our grammar does not generate epsilon. I mean, epsilon, empty string is not a valid expression in our grammar. Therefore, we will not be able to say that epsilon is going to be the first valid expression, valid terminal in this particular. Yeah. Okay, good. So it is going to be opening parenthesis and ID. So how do you derive that? So for the benefit of everybody, first of E is going to be first of T. If T is nullable, then first of E prime will also come into picture. If E prime is also nullable, then dollar will also be in the first of E. Right? It so happens that T is not nullable, that is, T does not derive epsilon, and therefore we don't have to worry about E prime, first of E prime or dollar. Right? What is first of T? That is what is the answer we want. That is same as first of F. And that is non-nullable, which we will see soon, and therefore we don't have to worry about T prime. F derives opening parenthesis something, and then ID and something, and therefore first of F is going to contain opening parenthesis and ID, and the same will be first of T, and the same will be first of E. So that is what we are going to do right now. That is same as this one. This is okay? Anybody has any questions on this one? Okay. Now you have to tell me what is going to be the first of E prime and first of T prime. So now Sarthak's answer will come in handy for us. अरे सॉरी वॉरी मत बोलते जाओ यार, इट्स ओके, वी आर अलाउड टू कमिट मिस्टेक्स. ओके, सो व्हाट इज फर्स्ट ऑफ ई प्राइम? सो वन थिंग इज दैट प्लस इज डेफिनेटली गोइंग टू कम देयर, एप्सिलॉन इज आल्सो गोइंग टू कम देयर. इज देयर एनीथिंग एल्स दैट इज गोइंग टू बी प्रेजेंट? Only those two? Okay, there are more answers. Plus epsilon and star epsilon. For T prime star epsilon. Okay. Sure. Okay. So all of you agree that nothing else is going to come. And that seems logical because we are talking about only this rule E prime and there is nothing else. So first of E prime should contain only plus and epsilon. And for T prime, as Arnav has suggested, star and epsilon are going to be part of T prime's first set. Okay. Now let's write about the follow set. What is follow set of E? Follow set of E definitely contains dollar, that is given to us because E is the starting symbol. What else is there in the follow set of E, capital E?
Right.
So the closing parenthesis is going to be in the follow set of E, because that is what is there in this particular production. Anything else is going to be there? Okay. So let's talk about follow set of capital T. If for somebody this is not clear, please ask. I'm just going ahead assuming that you are able to derive it, but if something is unclear, please ask. So follow set of T. So that T has a interesting connotation. While you guys are deriving it, and they say that the habit of T is very difficult to leave, right? And the reason why they say habit is difficult to leave is because even if you try a lot out of the habit, even if you try a lot, a bit remains. And even if you try further from a bit remains. And then even if you try, it remains. And even if you try further, T still remains. So the habit of T is difficult to get over. Okay, so dollar and can you explain follow set of E again? Sure. So follow set of E is definitely dollar is going to be there, because E is the starting symbol, so that is our special end marker. But in all of the productions, when we look at capital E's presence, we need to check what is there on the right hand side, what is the next symbol that is going to appear. In this case, it so happens that it's there only in the production of F, and the next symbol is closing parenthesis, therefore we add closing parenthesis also. But if it so happens that after capital E in some production there is, let's say, some other non-terminal, then the first of that non-terminal will also be in the follow set of capital E. Second, if that non-terminal is nullable, that is it derives epsilon, then whatever is the next symbol of that, whatever is the remaining, let's say, if this is E, pardon me for that, X, this is capital X, please assume that, and capital Y. Let me put it capital Z also. So if E is, if we have to find the E of follow set of E and X, so first of X is definitely going to be in the follow set of E. But if X is nullable, then the first of YZ is also going to be in the follow set of E. If Y is non-nullable, then first of Y suffices. If Y becomes non, if Y is nullable, then the first of Z also comes into picture. Right? If X, Y, Z all are nullable, then follow set of E should contain everything which is the follow set of, let's say in this case, F. Right? So if X, Y, Z are nullable, then the follow set of E also contains follow set of F. That is what it means. Any questions on this one? Okay, so only one of you has written plus dollar in the follow set of, what is plus dollar? That is the follow set of T, okay. Okay, so let's work it out. So let me remove this part. Oops. So the follow set of T is going to contain, let's check that, T appears here. So the first of E prime is definitely going to be in the follow set of T, right? From the first production as well as the second production. So the first of T, E prime is going to be plus an epsilon, right? I should mention that the follow set does not contain epsilon. Right? The first contains epsilon, but the follow set does not contain epsilon. Right? So the follow of, okay, so that plus is definitely going to be here. So that is coming from the first of, because it is nullable. So now the E prime is nullable, and therefore follow of E is also going to be in the follow of capital T, and therefore these two are going to get borrowed here. So plus, closing parenthesis, as well as dollar are going to be in the follow set of capital T. Does that make sense? I'll repeat that again, right? So E prime is nullable. So, okay, follow of capital T should contain first of E prime. First of E prime is plus and epsilon. Epsilon means that E prime is nullable. So follow set does not contain epsilon. So follow set definitely is going to add this plus. And since it is nullable, follow of E should also be there in the follow of capital T, because E prime is nullable. And therefore, whatever is follow of E, which we have already computed as a closing parenthesis and dollar, that should get added to the follow of T. Is this clear? There is no other mention of T in any of the other productions, and therefore we don't have to worry about it. Right? There is one definite presence in this second production, E prime deriving plus T E prime, but that is just self-referencing, because follow of T is going to be again first of E prime contains plus and it is nullable, and therefore follow of E prime should be there in the follow of capital T. In this case, it so happens that we have not yet computed follow of E prime. So that indicates that you might have to iteratively do this. So when we compute follow of E prime, at that time, we will check if anything of that is missing in follow of capital T. If it is missing, then we have to update follow of T. In this case, it's not going to happen, but yeah, that should be remembered. Any concerns here? Okay, so then I assume that you have understood follow of T. So now let's do follow of F. This should be very similar to follow of T, because the productions are very similar. Suddenly the number of responses has reduced. Okay. Okay, four of them, plus star, closing parenthesis, dollar, okay, good, all of you are getting the same answer, good. So that does indicate that you guys are on the same page. Okay, so let's try to understand that. So follow of F is going to be derived from first of T prime here and first of T prime here. First of T prime is going to be star, definitely, so that is going to get added, and then T prime is nullable, and therefore we have to add follow of T as well as follow of T prime into the follow set of capital F. Follow set of T is plus closing parenthesis dollar, so all that is going to get included. Follow set of T prime we have not yet computed. Whenever we compute it, we will check if any of that needs to be included. Okay, so that seems to be correct, plus star, closing parenthesis, dollar. Anybody has any confusion in this follow of F or follow of T? Anybody wants me to repeat that? Please let me. So So this follow, as you can see, is the next symbol which is going to be there after upper. So if I am recursively descending into a particular non-terminal, then I just look at what is going to be the follow set. If that is there in the input, then I am on the right track. If that is not the case, then I know that this particular construct, this particular non-terminal has an issue. So that is what we are going to build as a parsing table. And when we come to LL1 grams. Okay, so then follow of E prime. Okay, good. So some of you are getting it. I'll wait for a few more seconds for others to try out. So follow of E prime is going to be coming only from these two, first two productions. And follow of E prime is going to contain follow of E prime. That is what the second rule says. And follow of E prime is going to contain follow of E. Right? And therefore, closing parenthesis and dollar both are going to be in the follow of E prime. And now by looking at follow of E prime, you can see that there is nothing more needed to be added to follow of T, and therefore that reaches a stabilization or a fixed point. In general, this is an iterative process. So it's possible that the non-terminals might be dependent on each other, and therefore you might have to iteratively go over these sets until these reach saturation. Okay, and that should be clear what is going to be follow of then the T prime. Yeah. Follow of T prime should just contain follow of T, Naman. So it should not contain star. Yeah, correct. Okay. So that sounds good. As we were discussing, follow of T prime, that is going to come here and here. The second production is not going to give us anything. The first production is going to say that follow of T prime should contain everything from follow of T, which is plus closing parenthesis dollar. So that is what should be included in the follow of T prime. Okay. Alrighty. So any questions on this part? So this first and follow should be clear. Once we have that, then we'll be able to make use of it in multiple places. Right. So these are important concepts. These are going to be used in multiple places. Right. So if you have any confusion in anything, please ask. We'll of course do more exercises, so hopefully it will become clearer. Okay, so let me move ahead. So I have this first and follow, right? So that is something which I have done, but note that our goal was to do top-down parsing. Okay. So I am just putting it into a nice tabular form, and now what I am going to do is to create a parsing table. This parsing table is going to be used all through top-down parsing, bottom-up parsing, all different kinds of parsing, SLR, LALR, etc. So what I have on the in the first column is all the non-terminals, and that is if I am in a particular non-terminal and the symbol that I am going to utilize, right, or the look-ahead is going to be any of these tokens, which is different columns in this parsing table, then what is the rule that I should apply, that needs to be written into these different sets. So this is our 6x5 table or 5x6 table. In these 30 entries, what are the productions that should be applied whenever I am in a particular non-terminal and I see this symbol coming, what I should do, that is the parsing table. So once I have computed first and follow, this parsing table helps me to pass the input. So if I have an input and I am in a particular starting symbol, depending upon the next input, I am just going to apply that particular. It becomes as simple as this. Okay, so let's do that. So capital E is going to be looking at only the two symbols. One is of course opening parenthesis, and the other one is ID. So if I am trying to derive from the starting symbol capital E, and there is a question here. As follow of one non-terminal might depend on follow of other non-terminal, so will be the graph be always that? No, it can contain cycles, and therefore we require that iterative fixed point computation. That is correct, but it will reach a fixed point. Can you give a small argument to that? Why will it always reach a fixed point? This observation is correct that in this case probably it turned out to be a DAG, but in general it need not be a DAG. So it can create cycles. A might depend upon capital S might depend upon capital A, and so on. So what is the argument that this always non-left recursive? Okay. Yeah, the argument that I was thinking about is that at least size of one set increases, and there is a cap on how much you can derive, right? The number of terminals remains the same because those are there in the set. So that as long as at least one set is changing, therefore you are always making progress and there is finite entity there. Okay, good. So that seems to be a valid argument. Okay, so let's do that for E. And what that means is that if I am trying to derive from the starting symbol and I see opening parenthesis coming, or let's say ID coming, then what is the rule that I should apply? Well, there is no other rule. There is only one rule deriving from capital E, and therefore that is TE prime must be applied whenever you see the first of E, right? So whenever you see first of E, these two characters, then you must apply this rule corresponding to capital E. That is what it says. If you have any other symbol coming into picture plus star closing parenthesis, then that does mean that your expression is starting from that symbol. And we know, at least like thinking about these expressions that we know of, these will not start with plus star and closing parenthesis for the language that we are talking about, right? So all of these are going to be erroneous productions. So these are the two valid productions, instances of the valid production only based on the first of capital E, right? And of course, if it is dollar, that is the how did we say that dollar? Because the dollar is going to accept the empty string. As soon as we get that, that is going to be a problem. Okay, I think this is going to be a special case. In general, whenever you have consumed everything related to capital E and then you see a dollar, right, at that time you accept the string. But the another side effect of this is going to be that it is also going to accept the empty string, which is not really belonging to this language. So that seems to be a special case. So that seems to be a problem here. Okay. But other than this, let's understand this. I'll probably think about it. I'll go back to the book and see if there is some more clarification given on this. All right. So once I know that this row of E is clear, if it is not clear, please ask. And if it is clear, then start writing the second row of this predictive parsing tree. Okay. So by the way, this word predictive is a little misnomer. It doesn't predict as such. I mean, there is nothing non-deterministic here. It's just that by looking at the symbols that are coming up, I'm going to make a decision. And therefore, it says that I'm going to apply this particular rule. So when it applies this rule, E deriving TE prime, it has not consumed ID. The consumption of ID is going to happen in F deriving ID. And therefore, this is still a look ahead symbol. What is the next symbol on the input? And therefore, it is called as a predictive parsing table. Okay, so E prime's rules are going to be what? So E prime is going to be a little tricky because there is epsilon in the input, epsilon in the first of E prime, but there is no epsilon in any of these columns. So we should not have epsilon in these columns. So can somebody tell me what all is okay? Naman has said. E plus TE prime. So on plus it is going to be okay, empty and then plus TE prime. Okay. But it is also nullable. Right? So as soon as something is nullable, so that part is fine, Naman, that plus is going to be in the first and therefore in the cell corresponding to E prime and plus, we should have this particular rule plus TE prime, right? But there is another production, E prime deriving epsilon. That E prime deriving epsilon should be there in some box. What could that box be? Because otherwise we'll never apply that. So for closing parenthesis, there should be E prime deriving epsilon. Why? Why on closing parenthesis E prime should derive epsilon? That is what is going to happen when you have, right? That is what is going to happen when you look at the parse tree. That is what we did on the previous slide when we were deriving all those ID plus ID into ID. So it is going to be in the closing parenthesis because it is in the follow of E prime. So understand this. So E prime is trying to derive empty string. Why should it derive empty string? Because the next character in the input that is coming, it should be a valid character. What should be a valid character? Whatever is the follow of E prime is the valid character or valid token. Right? Follow of E prime contains closing parenthesis and dollar. So on each of these two columns, we should have E prime deriving epsilon. Does that make sense? So these opening parenthesis and dollar, these are in the follow set of E prime. So that is what is, that is where we have E prime deriving epsilon. Okay, let's do it for T. All right, so T should be relatively easy because there is only one rule for T as well as there is nothing nullable there. And therefore, just first of T is going to be opening parenthesis and ID. So opening parenthesis and ID, there should be a rule which says that, okay, so I should probably go back. So opening parenthesis and ID, on those we are going to have FT prime, right? So there will be an entry. Opening parenthesis here and ID. Any questions so far? Okay, so let's do it for T prime. T prime should have similarity with E prime because of the epsilon rule as well as multiple rules. So T prime on star should derive star F T prime. That seems fine. And T prime deriving epsilon should be there in it should be there in the follow of t prime, and that is what we'll do here. So follow of t prime is plus closing parenthesis and dollar. So all of these will contain t prime deriving epsilon. For f deriving id, it is going to be only in the id column. F deriving parenthesized expression should be there only in the opening parenthesis. Anybody who has not understood this predictive parsing table? Mother Reddit should be also there in the dollar, because the follow of T prime contains dollar also. That many times gets missed. Can we say that we can accept whenever there is an epsilon production in dollar column? Whenever there is an epsilon production in dollar column. No, that is not clear. I mean, in this particular example, only on the dollar. I mean, in this particular example, you might be able to see, but otherwise, this epsilon, this dollar may not be in the follow of except the last terminal, right? So, and it might not derive epsilon. That's also one of the things. In this case, it so happened that e prime and t prime are deriving are nullable, but otherwise, that need not be the case. So, we cannot say that. How do we know which production rule gives the first symbol? Yeah, so that needs to be, that needs to be explicitly mentioned, that E is the starting symbol or capital S is the starting symbol. Typically, typically we write the code in such a manner that the first non-terminal, first rule says, talks about the starting symbol. In case of YAP, for example, we give this percent start or whatever is the first rule that gets taken as the starting symbol. In this case, it has to be explicitly given. If it is not given, assume that the first rule has the starting symbol. Any other concerns, questions? Okay. So, we have exceeded the time anyway. So, we'll stop here, but parsing table is something which we have to continue using. So if in case something is misunderstood or not understood, please go back, read through this. And if there are questions, we can take those up tomorrow. Okay. All right. See you then. What type of grammar is done by this? This is just LL1 grammar that we are going to. No, left recursive will not work. So none of the top-down grammars, none of the LL1 grammars rather, can have left recursive. Right? So left recursive grammar we won't be able to do. Yeah, sure, Raghu, go ahead. So if the grammar is left recursive, you'll have to convert it to non-left recursive and then utilize this. That is possible. But there are grammars which cannot be done using top-down parsing. There are grammars, and we are going to see some example, that we cannot parse using this top-down parsing. Int star p equal to ampersand of 10.